Legacy Sunday as a foundation, and prayerfully even the legacy of the Word of God. Mark chapter number 6, verse 7 is where we're heading today. I thought it'd be a great passage of scripture for us to just start off with as we kind of begin our journey towards a season of remembering, a season of, as our logo says, pressing pause to remember, and certainly pressing play to move forward. We're going to spend some time in some pausing so we can indeed do some reflecting. Mark chapter number 6 is on the screen or the wall. The screen will be up there soon. Again, that's part of the 5-yard line location. Praise God. Follow along any way you like. I think I'm reading from the Message translation, so it may read a little bit differently, but the word of the Lord says this. Verse number 7. Jesus called the 12 to him. How many of you know we have been called by God, called by Christ? Amen. So Jesus calls the 12 to him. You are not here unless you have been called. And I know some folk may think that you've sanctified and you've been holy and right your whole life. But for the rest of us, how many glad that we were called by God? Amen. And sent them out in pairs. He gave them authority and power to deal with the evil opposition. He sent them off with these instructions. Don't think you need a lot of extra equipment for this. You are the equipment. Pat yourself on the chest, say, I am the equipment. Say that, I am the equipment. No special appeals for funds. Just keep it simple. No luxury inns. Get a modest place and be content there until you leave. Man, that just messes up all kind of folk theology, don't it? Man, I understand why folks don't like to read their Bible too much. Amen. And verse number 11, if you're not welcomed, not listened to, quietly withdraw. Don't make a scene. Shrug your shoulders and be on your way. So then they were on the road, and they preached with joyful urgency that life can be radically different. Right and left, they sent the demons packing. They brought wellness to the sick, anointing their bodies, healing their spirits. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. So we're going to speak from the topic simply today. Let's get free. Let's get free. Bow your heads with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the word of God that is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. We thank you, Lord God, for the gift of your word that continues to remind us of our mandate. Bless us, Lord God, as we have heard your word. I pray, God, that it will marinate, and as we meditate and reflect on it, I pray that it will cause transformation. Touch me as your preacher, hide me behind your cross, and send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest upon me, and even the hearers of this word, in Jesus' name we pray, that the people of God say amen. Amen. All right, give your neighbor a high five and tell them, let's get free. Let's get free. Let's get free. Now, it is the hope of every generation, I believe, to leave a legacy, a heritage, a track record that can be used as a foundation for the following generation, the subsequent generation, those who will come after us, to look on not only with pride, but with utility. To be able to feel like you don't have to start from zero, but that you can at least take one step above that which you are, where you started, that you're not starting at a deficit place. You're not starting at a place where you're just always feeling like you have to make it up from scratch. And one of the greatest legacies we, the followers of Jesus, have is the life of Jesus. It is the legacy. It is the example. It should be paradigmatic of the way in which we live. We are not a people who are looking for some instructions. That's why I love this passage. Because Jesus, when he calls us, he gives us instructions. Man, we were at the Vatican. I didn't get a chance to share some of these stories with y'all. I was going to do it that Sunday with Council Church. I had a nice PowerPoint presentation. But it was so, you know, fascinating, some of the things that happened in some of our meetings at the Vatican. One of the meetings was with a Bishop Sanchez. He was from Argentina. He's one of Pope Francis' really good friends. They came up in the priesthood together, and he was talking with us because while we were there, there were a lot of folks from the U.S. Embassy or somewhere that were not very happy we were there because they didn't like that we were coming there talking about mass incarceration. They didn't like that we were coming there talking about economic inequality and racism. Their message to the papal powers in Rome and the Vatican were that everything in the United States was going okay. So when the Pope comes, he just needs to be mindful that this is not a third world, underdeveloped southern hemisphere country. It's kind of what was expressed to us. But the bishop was like, so I'm so glad that you're here because you being here reminds and affirms what many of us have already known. And he said, you know, we've been following what's happening in Ferguson. We've been following what was happening in Baltimore and New York. That many of us have been tracking all of these things. And we were having a conversation with some of the folks from the church delegation in the United States, and they were telling us that this Pope and this Vatican is not reflective of the real church. Because he's talking so much about the poor and all these other things. And the bishop told us, well, how can you folk over in America claim to be the real church when you don't even believe the Beatitudes and the Sermon on the Mount? So I'm sitting there because I've been in a lot of church meetings, and usually, you know, if you're not a part of that church tradition, they don't like air their dirty laundry. Probably because folks go back home and preach a sermon on it like this. But you know, that's what he said, and the people responded back to him. They said, the Beatitudes and the Sermon on the Mount is a mystery. You know, it's not easy for everyone to grasp it. And the bishop slammed his hand on the desk and said, it is not a mystery. It is a project, and you better get back on the right project. And it reminded me of this quote that one of my mentors in seminary said, that the church does not have a social strategy, because the church is a social strategy. That our legacy, our calling, is to indeed challenge the forces as they present themselves personally, structurally, environmentally, whatever, to help bring freedom and liberation from the sins that are radically personal all the way to the sins that are radically structural. This legacy, if you will, is a legacy that has often found its way, depending on who is trying to tell the story, either very kind of truncated, half told, or often, in many respects, not told at all. And if you and I are careful, we can easily forget that the legacy we are called to build our lives on has been shown to us on full display through the life and teachings of Jesus. And the rest of our lives then must be about how do we live into that legacy of setting people free. When Jesus was first launching his public ministry, his first words were, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to preach the gospel, proclaim liberty. You know what liberty means, right? Freedom to those who are oppressed, to those who are in jail, to those who are afflicted. And often in some of our spiritual interpretations, we spiritualize that and not realize that there are many ways that we are bound. Hello, somebody. Many ways that we are bound. And if we are not honest about those many forms of bondage, then we can allow church, nations, our culture, our families, our ministries, our vocations, all of these things to contribute to our bondage rather than our liberation. And this is why it is so important for you and I to appreciate that we have a story and a legacy that must not only be embraced, but at all times it should be interrogated. We should question it. We should look at it, and we should study it. We should remind ourselves that the greatest gift of the faith and legacy we have is that it can withstand our scrutiny. And we're not being asked to just accept things without any kind of questions, but we are then being also asked that even when you get answers you may not like or agree with, part of our legacy is to embrace that truth and keep it 100. Hello, somebody. Now, some of what you and I must appreciate in this moment in which we're living is that there is a legacy of oppression, a legacy of exclusion, a legacy of all kinds of things. And even this last 48 hours, many of us, I feel conflicted because, you know, we just celebrated July 4th and Independence Day and all these different kinds of things. But how many of you know Independence Day wasn't a day of great liberation for everybody? Hello, somebody. Amen. And some of this requires our scrutiny. Why? Because if we do not interrogate some of the narratives and some of the stories that often make up our legacies, we can be, in many respects, locking ourselves into or re-inscribing forms of bondage that we need to be set free from. And I was captivated by, this was going around on Facebook, this idea or this story or this speech that Frederick Douglass delivered on July 4th, 17 or 1865, something like that. But I found a nice little a video reenactment of this, and I thought I'd play it. It's about 3 minutes long, but I thought it'd be super dope for us to see and hear how Frederick Douglass, who at the time self-identified, and I want to believe him, that he was a follower of Jesus. Amen. Hello, somebody. Amen. Because how many know folks want to evacuate the freedom fighters' spirituality and just say that they were only Christians because the slave master made them to be Christians? But I want to rebuke that, amen, because I want to take their own word seriously. Amen. Amen. You can't quote these folk on one hand and then deny what they say is the source of their own inspiration and salvation. Somebody shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. So take a look at that and how, this is going to be so dark that you may not even make this brother out, but you'll at least hear the words. Go ahead.
Fellow citizens, pardon me, and allow me to ask, why am I called upon here to speak to you today? What am I or anyone I represent to do with your national independence? Or are the great promises of political freedom and natural justice embodied in the Declaration of Independence extended to us or to God for both your sakes and ours? An affirmative answer that truthfully returns to the question, but such is not the state of the case. I say with a sad sense of disparity between us, I am not included within the pale of your glorious anniversary. Your high independence only reveals the immeasurable distance between us. The blessings you celebrate this day and rejoice is not enjoyed in common. The rich inheritance of life, liberty, prosperity, and independence granted to you by your forefathers are not shared by me. The sunlight that brought life and health to you brought stripes and death to me. This 4th of July is yours, not mine. You may rejoice, I must mourn. To drag a man in feathers in the grand illuminated temple of liberty and call upon him to join you in joyous anthems is inhuman mockery and sacrilegious irony. Do you mean to mock me, fellow citizens, by calling me here to speak to you today? If so, there's a parallel in the conduct, and I must warn you that it is dangerous to copy a nation whose crimes towering up to heaven were thrown down by the breath of the Almighty and that nation buried in irrevocable ruin. I stand today with the cries of appealed and woe-smitten people. Fellow citizens, standing there, being identified with the American bondman, making his wrong mind, I cannot hesitate to declare with all my soul, the character and conduct of this nation never looked blacker than on this 4th of July. And what to the American slave is the 4th of July? I answer, a day that revealed to him more than any other day of the year the gross conduct and injustice to which he is the constant victim. To him, your celebration is a sham. Your boasted liberty and holy license. Your sounds of rejoicing, empty and heartless. Your songs and hymns, your sermons and thanksgivings are to him mere fraud, impiety, deception, and hypocrisy, a thin veil covering up crimes that would disgrace a nation of savages. There's not a nation on earth guilty of practices more bloody and shocking than are these people of the United States at this very hour. Am I to argue that man is entitled to liberty? That he is the rightful owner of his own body? You have declared on the 4th of July. Am I to argue the wrongfulness of slavery then? To do so would make myself look ridiculous and offer an insult to your understanding. There is not a man under the canopy of stars that does not know that slavery is wrong for him. What then remains to be argued is that slavery is not divine? That God did not establish it? That the doctors of divinity were mistaken and performed blasphemy in the thought? That which is inhuman cannot be divine. Who could believe in such a proposition? They that can may, I cannot. For the time for such argument is past. I never saw so many ghostly looking faces as I did on that 4th of July. Fellow citizens, pardon me.
At a time like this, he says, it is not light that is needed, but fire. It is not the gentle shower, but thunder. We need the storm, the whirlwind, the earthquake. The feeling of the nation must be quickened, and the conscience of the nation must be roused. The propriety of the nation must be startled. The hypocrisy of the nation must be exposed. And the crimes against God and man must be proclaimed and denounced. Now, this is part, to me, of an important role that I believe we, the Way Christian Center, as we are embarking on this celebration of 10 years, we must appreciate that there are many contributors to this legacy that we are building our forward movement upon. I love Psalm 16, verses 5 through 6, and it says, I think I have that slide, that the Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. Somebody holler, I have a beautiful inheritance. I have a beautiful inheritance. This beautiful inheritance is part and parcel of all the things that make up our legacy. And how many of you know that your legacy is not something you always get to choose? Hello, somebody. You don't get to choose who your parents are, who your kinfolk are, what neighborhood you live in, even what country that you are born into. But how many of you know that the gift of your legacy, when you are a follower of the ways of Jesus, is that that legacy can always be redeemed. That legacy can always be turned around. And part of the project of modernity, one of my seminary professors, his name is Stanley Hauerwas, he said it like this, that the project of modernity is to produce a people who believe, listen, this is one of his most famous twisted, worded quotes, but I love it. He says, where people would believe that they have no story except for the story that they chose when they had no story. Amen. Don't that just make your head just get a little dizzy? Amen, right? This idea where to be free in America is really about us thinking we have the freedom to choose whether I can get things or whether I can be described as a certain kind of a person or if I can live in a certain neighborhood. That is the extent to which you and I are being shaped to believe freedom in this country is. But how many of you know that there is another kind kind of freedom that is a part of the legacy that has produced us as followers of God. And that legacy has been handed on to us often by our parents and our grandparents and our elders. This other scripture that 2 Timothy starts to lift up that I love, as Paul is talking to Timothy, he says that I remember your tears and I long to see you, that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt, listen, first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am sure dwells in you as well. That you have a faith, we have a faith that is our legacy, and it has been deposited within us because of the people who came before us. I hope y'all with me this morning, amen. You did not get here just because you clicked your heels and wished upon a star. Amen. You did not get a hold to this faith just because a great idea just dropped out of heaven upside your head. But how many of you know that I am here today because, as the mother used to say, somebody prayed for me. Had me on their mind, took the time to pray for me. This is the example of the kind of legacy that you and I are living into. It is a legacy of sometimes great trauma. It is a legacy of sometimes great struggle. It is a legacy of sometimes great oppression. And it is a legacy of great faith. It is a legacy of overcoming. It is a legacy of serving the one true living God. And in a moment in time where folks will not try to make us think that we can continue to be the people we have historically been without being committed to the worship and service to the one true God, is a part of the lie that is told when you forget your legacy. Lord, I wish I had a church to talk to you every day. Give your neighbor one high five and tell them, don't forget your legacy. Don't forget your legacy. Why? Because in forgetting your legacy, you forget what the price was paid that caused us to be set free. Oh, somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now you got to realize that just like the scripture I just read, Lois and Eunice and all these other folks have left a legacy for us to draw from. How many of you know you are leaving a legacy for others as well? Can I talk to you today? Amen. What will people remember about us when we're gone? What will they say about you and I when we have moved on from this present assignment? We acknowledge these giants among us, as Anton said, because it's important to know that we are already benefiting from the legacy that they have created. And even this church, some of us wonder why would we spend resources, why would you invest money into a building when we are the church? How many of you know? Because even when you're gone, this will remain as a legacy for others to benefit from. Not everybody who is in this room today was here back in 1972. Why? Because that was a seed that was being planted, so you today, some 30-something years later, could experience something that you would not get anywhere else. Lord, I feel something. And you've got to ask yourself, what are you leaving behind? Are you just leaving behind your Facebook page and your profile? Are you leaving behind your digital footprint? Are you leaving behind your thesis statement? Or can you believe that there's something more eternal that God wants you and I to leave behind that will bless people even if they never meet us one day in their life? This is the legacy that we are being called to produce, and this legacy must produce liberation and freedom. This legacy must be able to set folk free. People must be able to look at what we have produced and feel like if I have touched that, if I engage with that, I will become a more free brother, a more free sister. I will be more free than I was before I got a hold to that thing. And I want to believe that the greatest liberator in history has a name, and we called his name a little earlier. His name is Jesus. deliver and produce and nurture. And there are a few ways in the text, as I hurry to a close here, that we find you and I must be mindful of if we will be freedom fighting, legacy leaving followers of the Most High God. The first thing that I love in this text, it says that they were called with authority to preach with joyful urgency. And my brothers and sisters, that's one of the first things you and I must embrace, is that we've all been called to preach. Somebody holler, preach. Now understand that preaching is more than standing up here on a Sunday morning delivering a reflection of a biblical text. How many of you know, as St. Francis of Assisi says, you can preach the gospel at all times, and sometimes you can use your words. That many of us think that preaching can only happen when you're talking, but how many of you know we got a lot of talking preachers, but we don't got a lot of doing preachers. We got a lot of folks who are gifted, amen, with the ability to parse a statement and interpret a foreign language and ruminate on a philosophical, esoteric text or phrase. But when it comes down to your life every day, being an example that other folks can read and be inspired by and be set free by, how many of you know we don't have enough living, doing preachers as we do talking preachers? And listen, my brothers and sisters, all of us are called to preach. Amen. You may never get this role, but tell your neighbor, I got a message to tell. You may never get a pulpit, but tell somebody, I got a story to tell. And that story must be told with joyful urgency. I want you to think about, what does it mean to tell a story with joyful urgency? What does it mean for you to tell a story that is so joyful that it creates a sense of urgency? How many of you have ever had a good secret that you were told you couldn't tell nobody, but it was so good to you that you just couldn't keep it to yourself? Anybody ever had that? Amen. So that's gossip. You know I'm telling the truth. Amen. But anybody ever had a good story? Amen. A good, like somebody was getting a surprise and you like, you know, I know I can't tell it. I know I can't tell nobody about it. This surprise party, this new car, this new job, this proposal that's getting ready to happen. There's something new and joyful, and I'm urgently trying to tell it, but I'm told I'm not supposed to tell it. I wonder what kind of joyful urgency do you have in your soul about what God has done for you, about the story that God has produced in your life. There's a difference, you know, between being joyful and between being happy. How many of you know there's a lot of folk who are happy one day and unhappy the next? But don't you know that the difference between being happy is that, you know, you may lose your happiness tomorrow, but your joy will be there persistently. Your joy won't run out. Why? Because this joy that you have, the world didn't give it to you, and the world can't take it away. Oh, I feel like preaching a little bit in here. Somebody shout hallelujah. This preaching of the gospel at all times is an ambition that the Apostle Paul talked about in Romans chapter 15, verse 20. He says it like this, that I made it my ambition to preach the good news, not where Christ has already been named, so that I do not build on someone else's foundation. But as it is written, those who have never been told of him shall see him, and those who have never heard of him shall understand. This preaching as your number one ambition must be what you wake up every day and ask God to give you the wisdom and the creativity to accomplish. You must be a preacher on your job. You must be a preacher at your school. You must be a preacher on the street corner. You must be a preacher in the boardroom. You must be a preacher in the classroom. And I'm not talking about a preacher that needs a milk carton and a megaphone. I'm talking about somebody who can live in such a way that people will be so persuaded by the sermon you are preaching that is unique to your own experience that they will have to look at you and say, burden that you live out every day. Lift your hand, somebody, and shout hallelujah. The second thing that the text says for us that is important, if we're going to help get free, is that we have to cast out the demons and evil in all of its forms. Somebody holler, cast out the devil. I think I said it last week or 2 weeks ago, that you may be full of the devil, but that don't mean you are the devil. And I really believe that thing. Some of us get confused because people get on our nerves so much, and we interact with individuals and people, and we think that they are the devil. But how many of you know we don't wrestle against flesh and blood? We don't wrestle against the enemies that we can see with our own eyes, but we have powers and evil forces that require our ability to maim them and cast them out. Now, when Jesus was talking to his disciples in another time, he said to them that these things only come out by prayer and fasting. And I want to give you a couple of things that you must be mindful of if you're going to cast out the evil in all of his many forms. That you got to be a person of prayer. You have to be a person of fasting, of study, of discipline. You have to engage in the disciplines that give you the power you need to defeat the evil forces wherever they show up. And I know for a fact that there are a lot of evil forces that have people's minds and have people's hearts. There are lots of evil forces that have the systems and the structures of this world. And this is why you and I must make sure every time we are engaging in work that is about casting out evil forces, casting out evil forces of racism and structural oppression, casting out evil forces of mental abuse and physical abuse, casting out evil forces of lying and stealing and cheating, casting out evil forces of manipulation and humiliation, casting out evil forces of fornication and adultery, casting out evil forces that will try to make some lives less valuable than others. Whenever we are dealing with these evil forces, don't you dare show up to the fight without your prayer and your fasting and your study. Because that evil force will not respond to Michael McBride, but that evil force will respond to the God that lives inside Michael McBride. And whatever your name is, give your neighbor a high five and tell him, I got something inside of me. And what's inside of me is a weapon that is not of human origin, but it is mighty through God to the pulling down of some strongholds. Do I have anybody that knows what I'm talking about in here today? I'm talking about the Holy Ghost. Give your neighbor a hallelujah and tell him, I'm glad I got the Holy Ghost. It is the acknowledgement that Jesus is Lord. It is the realization that without him, you can't do nothing. But it is also the realization that justice and righteousness belongs to God. It is the realization that you may have some sickness in your life, and salvation has come to heal you and to make you well. It is the body. And if you're going to save a body, you've got to save a soul. I wish I had somebody that knew what that kind of work looked like. Jesus gave them instructions. He said, anoint somebody. Don't you know what anointing is? Anointing is the express presence of the eternal power of God. When you bring the anointing into a situation, don't you know that that situation has got to change? That situation won't stay the same. And some of us are trying to do the healing work without the anointing of God. But listen, the Bible says in Isaiah 10:27 that the day will come to pass that the burden will be taken from your shoulders, and the chains and the yoke that is around your neck will be destroyed because of the anointing of God. And I just want you to know, my brothers and sisters, that God has given us access to this anointing. And it is this anointing that will set you and I free. How many of you know that even though I may be in jail, I can still be free? Even though I may be suffering from the forms of oppression, I still can be set free. Although my mind may be cluttered and my heart may be broken, I can still be free. I know that I may have confusion, I may have some trouble on every side, but I believe that I can still be free. I know that everybody may need me and walk out on me, but I believe that I can still be free. I know that I may not know where my money is coming from, or where my boo is going to be tomorrow, but this one thing I know, that the God who is the one that sets me free ain't waiting on a document to say I'm free. Ain't waiting on a president to say I'm free.